Hello, everyone. Today we're going to discuss Annihilation 3, Immolation. As the biologist walks toward the lighthouse, she has a strange encounter with two dolphins swimming down a canal. Then the dolphins breached, and it was almost as vivid a dislocation as that first descent into the tower. I knew that the dolphins here sometimes ventured in from the sea, had adapted to the freshwater. But when the mind expects a certain range of possibilities, any explanation that falls outside of that expectation can surprise. Then something more wrenching occurred. As they slid by, the nearest one rolled slightly to the side, and it stared at me with an eye that did not, in that brief flash, resemble a dolphin eye to me. It was painfully human, almost familiar. In an instant, that glimpse was gone, and they had submerged again, and I had no way to verify what I had seen. I stood there, watched those twin lines disappear up the canal, back toward the deserted village. I had the unsettling thought that the natural world around me had become a kind of camouflage. In one way, this scene reiterates the ideas about perspective we've been developing as we discuss this novel. The biologist notes that when the mind expects a certain range of possibilities, any explanation that falls outside of that expectation can surprise. Having been trained in biology, the biologist is not ready when things happen that fall outside of the concepts of the science that she has studied. But two other things happen during this encounter with the dolphin that might begin to change our own perspective on Area X. This strange dolphin seems to be staring at the biologist, and it seems to be staring at her with an eye that is human. Throughout this chapter of the novel, as the biologist heads toward and then explores the lighthouse, I think we get the increasing sense that Area X is watching the human beings who enter it and also trying to copy them. One of the members of the first expedition into Area X also had a sense of being watched, as the biologist discovers from studying their records. I felt as if I were both freer than ever before and more constrained, one member of the expedition said. I felt as if I could do anything as long as I did not mind being watched. And later, as the biologist walks toward the lighthouse and passes through the ruins of a town, she comes across what appears to be an attempt by the very plant life to copy the human figure. But in what had been kitchens or living rooms or bedrooms, I also saw a few peculiar eruptions of moss or lichen, rising 4 or 5 feet tall, misshapen, the vegetative matter forming an approximation of limbs and heads and torsos, as if there had been runoff from the material too heavy for gravity that had congregated at the foot of these objects. Or perhaps I imagined this effect. We don't know what Area X is. We don't know what happened to Area X, but we are beginning to get a sense of what Area X is doing. In a way, Area X seems to be studying human beings much like these human beings are studying Area X. Probably the strangest and the creepiest detail in this novel, at least the strangest and creepiest detail for me, is the organic writing on the inner walls of the tower. In this chapter, the biologist begins to theorize about what this organic writing might be. What could the words on the wall communicate to the tower? I had to assume, or thought I did, that the crawler didn't just live in the tower. It went far afield to gather the words, and it had to assimilate them, even if it didn't understand them, before it came back to the tower. The crawler had to, in a sense, memorize them, which was a form of absorption. The strings of sentences on the tower's walls could be evidence brought back by the crawler to be analyzed by the tower. The biologist's idea is that the crawler, her name for the creature that lives inside the tower and that appears to have killed the anthropologist, travels out into Area X, somewhere encounters human language, and then tries to replicate it on the tower's inner walls, producing the cryptic, almost but not quite sensible organic writing. That's an interesting theory. But what's most interesting, I think, is what the biologist writes in the very next paragraph. But there is a limit to thinking about even a small piece of something monumental. You still see the shadow of the whole rearing up behind you, and you become lost in your thoughts in part from the panic of realizing the size of that imagined leviathan. I had to leave it there, compartmentalized until I could write it all down and, seeing it on the page, begin to divine the true meaning. What is the biologist doing here? She's exploring Area X and writing down what she sees there, trying to reproduce what she sees with words, which is what the crawler appears to be doing, what Area X appears to be doing. The parallels between the expedition and Area X deepen when the biologist enters the lighthouse and discovers the mass of journals under a trap door. Like Area X itself, the members of the expedition have created a mass of text inside of a tower. Only this tower, the lighthouse, rises into the sky, while Area X's tower dives deep underground. The journals even make an impression on the biologist that is very similar to the impression made on her by the organic writing of the crawler. Reading through the journals, the biologist thinks, "But none of this placed me any closer to understanding why or who. We were all in the dark, scrabbling at the pile of journals. And if ever I felt the weight of my predecessors, it was there and then, lost in it all. At a certain point, I discovered I was so overwhelmed that I could not continue, could not even go through the motions. It was too much data, served up in too anecdotal a form. I could search those pages for years and perhaps never uncover the right secrets, while caught in a loop of wondering how long this place had existed, who had first left their journals here, why others had followed suit until it had become as inexorable as a long ingrained ritual." The words in the journals make some sense to the biologist, like the organic words in the tower do. But the words in the journals did not give her an understanding of who exactly the members of the previous expeditions were, or what happened to them. In the same way, the organic words in the tower did not give her an understanding of who or what wrote them, or why. She does not really know what the words in the journals mean, what the words try and fail to capture, and what the words leave out or do not even try to describe. In the same way, she does not know what the organic words in the tower ultimately mean. But all words really function this way. What is writing but an only partially successful attempt to copy, to reproduce, with words, something we've encountered in the world? I don't think the parallels drawn between the expeditions and Area X are meant to suggest that, deep down, human beings and Area X are similar. They seem to me to be completely foreign entities. But when human beings and Area X encounter each other, they seem to react in a similar way. They try to copy each other so as to try to understand each other. The human beings try to copy and understand Area X through writing, through the materials human beings have available to them, ink, letters, and words. Area X tries to copy and understand humanity by copying human beings and aspects of human life with its own materials, genes, cells, animals, and plant life. The animals in Area X begin to look human. Plants and fungi in Area X reproduce the shapes of human writing. Humans and Area X are responding to and recording each other. And another strange thing appears to be happening. As Area X tries to copy human life, and as humans try to copy down Area X and human beings seem to be beginning to blend. My flashlight, along with the natural light from the open trap door, revealed that the walls of the room were rife with striations of mold, some of which formed dull stripes of red and green. From below, the way the midden spilled out in ripples and hillocks of paper became more apparent. Torn pages, crushed pages, journal covers warped and damp. Slowly, the history of exploring Area X could be said to be turning into Area X. As our perspective on the relationship between human beings and Area X changes in this section of the novel, I think our perspective on the relationship between this novel and the real world also begins to change. The expeditions have been recording and trying to study Area X, but they have also, as the biologist figures out while exploring the lighthouse, been fighting with Area X. On the seaward side, another wall, an even stouter looking fortification high in the crumbling dune, topped with broken glass, and as I drew near, I could see crenellations that created lines of sight for rifles. It was all in danger of falling down the slope onto the beach below. But for it not to have done so already, whoever had built it must have dug its foundations deep. it appeared that some past defenders of the lighthouse had been at war with the sea. I did not like this wall because it provided evidence of a very specific kind of insanity. We don't know exactly what happened at this lighthouse in the past, but it looks to the biologist almost as if previous expeditions were at war with the sea. Area X is an area of nature that is, for some reason, changing dramatically. And it appears that many human beings are not responding intelligently to that change, that many are responding to it with violence. In previous classes, we've talked about how literature can help us think about larger psychological, social, cultural, and philosophical questions. I don't know what VanderMeer had in mind as he was writing this novel, but it's difficult for me to read this novel and not think about how human beings are responding to the dramatic changes in nature we are witnessing as the climate changes due to global warming, especially when I read a passage like this one. When Area X first appeared, there was vagueness and confusion, and it is still true that out in the world, not many people know that it exists. The government's version of events emphasized a localized environmental catastrophe stemming from experimental military research. This story leaked into the public sphere over a period of several months so that, like the proverbial frog in a hot pot, people found the news entering their consciousness gradually as part of the general daily noise of media oversaturation about ongoing ecological devastation. Within a year or two, it had become the province of conspiracy theorists and other fringe elements. By the time I volunteered and was given the security clearance to have a firm picture of the truth, the idea of an Area X lingered in many people's minds like a dark fairy tale, something they did not want to think about too closely, if they thought about it at all. We had so many other problems. Whatever VanderMeer intended with this novel, this paragraph appears to me to replicate, in fiction, how human beings have for a long time responded to the climate crisis. Governments downplaying its severity, fears about the crisis being written off as conspiracy theories or alarmism, most people not wanting to think about it too closely, wanting to focus on other problems instead. Annihilation is not a realistic novel, it's science fiction. But climate change is a danger so big that I think, for most people, it seems unrealistic. We struggle to grasp it, to understand it, to make sense of it, in a way that is very similar to, I think, the way the members of the expedition struggle to make sense of Area X.